Welcome to Online Study for You. This is a video on the TCF NQT mock test, and this session will be on the programming part of the test. So there will be an English section and there will be an aptitude section. So this video will be concentrating only on the programming and the coding section. So let us start with the test. So to give a brief introduction, TCS released their mock test link yesterday, wherein you will go to their website and you will write a test online, exactly same as you would write in a real examination that is going to be happen on 3rd and 4th. So let us get started. So here is the link of the test. So let us click this link, and this link will be opened in the your web browser. So this is the the structure of the website that we'll have. So whenever you will be writing your examination, your name will be written here. The system name you are writing will be written here, and you will have to enter your login ID and password. But since this is a mock examination, you don't have to enter any of those credentials. You just have to click this sign in button that will open the test in a new window. Okay, so you should not minimize this window for any cost. So you will be given instructions. So this means that you have not visited the question at all. This means you have not answered the question. So if it marks in red, if it marks in blue, green, it means you have answered the question. You can also mark your answers for review. For example, you answered one question and you want to come back again later and check if the answer is correct or not. You can also do that. Okay. So there are some rules that are given. Okay. So you can read that if you want. I'm going to click next, and you'll have to accept their terms and conditions. And after accepting the terms and conditions, you just have to say that I'm ready to begin, though examination will begin. So if you're writing a real exam, your name will be shown here. So the test has now been started. The first one will be the verbal ability, that is about the English. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to skip this. Okay. So I cannot directly skip this. So I should have at least started 1 minute into the test, only then I'll get the submit option. So after 1 minute, I'm going to press the submit option. What will happen after that is this English section you can see here will be submitted, and it will go to the quantitative aptitude section. Here also I should wait at least 1 minute, and after that I'm going to submit the answer, submit the test, and then it will go to the programming concept section, which we will be covering in this video, and also the coding section, which we'll be covering. Okay, so you can click here for instructions if you want. Okay, and all that. Okay, so this is, as I said, this is answer, not answer section, and you can get this. Okay, so you in the English section you have to select an answer. So I can answer this, but the purpose of this video is to cover only programming concepts, so I'll not deviate from the purpose and answer this. So now I'm going to submit this. It says I have answered zero and etc. So are you sure you want to submit this? Yes, I want to submit this, and I want to go for the quantitative to aptitude section. So I will have to proceed to this. So they will ask you a question, and here I have to wait again 1 minute minimum to submit this. So I will wait for again 1 minute to submit this. So you can look at the kind of questions that have been given. This is about a progression that is given, and here it is about like a percentage kind of a thing. Pretty easy question. This is about the arithmetic mean. If you know the formula, you can easily calculate. This is about a probability basic question. This is also a kind of permutation combination kind of question. Those are there. So if you want to know more about all these concepts, you should check out our channel. So we have also solved aptitude questions and English and verbal questions. So you would have to subscribe to our channel and press the bell icon to know more when our new video is submitted. So I can submit this section after 2 seconds. So I'm going to do that, and I'm going to head to the programming section. So here comes the programming section. What we will have is we'll be having 20 minutes to answer this. So let us quickly get into it. So which of the below data types occupies the most amount of memory? So options are these. So among these, double is the right answer, because double will occupy 8 bytes of memory. So int will occupy 4 bytes, char will occupy 1 byte, and float will occupy 2 bytes. So you can see the 20 minutes left. So I'm going to answer this question and say, so whenever an explanation is needed, I'm going to explain it to you. So since this is an easy question, I have not got into the depth of the question. So size of operator is used to get the size of what? So we have used a size of operator in the previous tutorials that we have solved in our channel. So you can check that out. So the data type of or variable, data type only, available free memory, program file in memory. So this would be the data type or variable. Okay, we can use this. Okay, so this is the answer, I believe. So the data type only will also be the answer, but according to me, data type or variable is the correct answer. You can also, you know, so the answer which I will be giving in this is not 100% right. You can cross check it, Google it. If some answer is wrong, just please comment it down. So even I can also be wrong. Okay, so let us go to the third question. A queue is what type of a structure? Sequential access structure, or first in, first out, last in, first out, circular list. So a queue is what type of a structure? You know the queue, right? So the queue which we will be forming daily to get into the bus or get into the grocery store or whatever. So a first person, this is a queue. So a first person will enter, a second person will enter, third person will enter, so a fourth person will enter. So the first person to enter, a first in, the person first to enter is the first to go out, FIFO, first in, first out. So our answer is the first in, first out, option B, the second option. So the next question is, the C built-in function to release the dynamic memory is. So this is, the answer for this question is free. So we know that we have functions like calloc and malloc, right? So we have discussed an MCQ also about this. So there are functions like calloc in C, and also there is a function called malloc in C. So what this will do is it will allocate memory in dynamically, okay? So this will allocate memory dynamically. So we are going to use the function free to remove the memory that have been allocated dynamically. So what happens is, whenever the program is running, some memory is allocated to store some data. Okay, so after exiting the program also, if the memory is executed allocated dynamically, this memory will not be cleared, it will be in the RAM. So we are going to use this function to delete this from the memory, since this is not required after our program runs. So our answer is option B, that is free. So the next question, which of the below is not predefined file stream in C language? So stdio is a predefined file stream. So you include stdio. Stdout is a file stream. Stdin is also a file stream. Stderr is not a file stream, because stdin is used to take input from the keyboard. So this stdio will contain stdin and stdout. That is why it is called as stdio. That is stand for stdin and stdout. So this stdio will contain these two. But there is no stderr, that is precisely stderr. So that is not there in the C language. So that will be our answer for this question. We'll go to the next question, which says, which statement is correct about circular linked list? So if you know about linked lists, the circular linked list looks something like this. So this is a linked list, as you know, okay? So there is a head for this. This head will be connected to this, okay? Then what happens is, I'm gonna just copy this and I'm gonna paste this. So let us imagine that there are three elements in our linked list. What happens in a circular linked list is that so this is connected to this, this is connected from the link, this link is connected to this, and what happens is, usually we will have a null at the end. But what happens in our circular linked list is that this will come back and point to this, okay? So this is a circular linked list, if you know. So here we can store some data. 3, 2, this doesn't look like a 3, please bear with me. So doubly linked list, a doubly circuit linked list is not possible to implement. There is no null pointer that points to null. actually this is our answer, because we can see that there is no null pointer here. If this was not a circular linked list, there would have been a null pointer here. So there is no null pointer here. So this is our answer. So can be used to implement undo feature in word processing. A node can be inserted but cannot be deleted. A node can be inserted and deleted in circular linked list. It cannot be used to implement undo. So we use stacks and queues for that. So this is the answer for this question. So the next is, in C language, we can find the length of a string using which function? This is a very easy question if you know the basics. So strlen is the right answer. We use this function to find the length of a given string. So let us say if I have a string that is, so let us say if I have a string like online study for you, okay. So I have, oh my bad, okay, I'll write hello. And if I have a string like that, so I can use the function, okay, strlen of this, okay. And if I say like int a, this a will have the length of this, that is 5. So this is the correct answer for this. Let us go to the next question, which is, which of the below is a fundamental data type in C language? So as you know, fundamental data types are already predefined in the C programming language. So structure, union, and boolean, or none of the other three options. So structure is not a fundamental data type. Union is also not a fundamental data type. Actually, boolean is a fundamental data type in a C language. So because boolean value can store a 0 or 1. So if we go to our IDE, let us say, if I say, I'll write a sample program, okay, to show this. I have an int main, I have my, so I'll say return 0. So what I can do is I can say, boolean ABC, okay, I can do this, but sometimes what I need is hash include bool.h, okay. So sometimes you can use just bool to declare boolean. So I'll say this is equal to true, okay. Next what I'll do is I can print this, okay, true value will print 1. So boolean is actually a basic data type, so I'm not sure about the correct option. So this can also be the answer, or this can also be the answer. So kindly search the internet and find the answer. So I'm going to go for none of the other three options, because boolean is not fundamental data type. Or let us Google here itself. So fundamental data types in C. So this will give me some options. The fundamental data types in C, it comes from Quora. And let us go to this website and see whether boolean is a fundamental data type. So I'm not sure whether it is yes or not. So bool is not a fundamental data type, so this is not in the list. You have to include it if you want to use that in your program. So our answer will be none of the other three options. So this is the correct answer for this. So the next question is, which statement is about recursion is false? So you know about recursion, right? So recursion is a function calling itself, okay? So whenever a function calls itself, say for example, we have a function like, I'll say, void abc, okay? It will say like int a, comma b, comma c. If it calls abc again inside this function, so whenever this function is called here, say abc like this, so this will call this function, and this function will call this function again, that will create a loop. So this is the correct answer for this question, that so which is the false statement for this question is the question. So recursion is always applicable for a function is a false statement, because for some functions you cannot apply recursion. So all these three statements are correct because in a recursive function, termination condition, base condition is specified definitely. So whenever this base condition reaches, the recursion will stop. So if the function does not converge to the base condition, it leads to an infinite recursion. This is true. Whenever we do not reach the base condition, the function will be calling itself again and again. It will go for an infinite loop. So then it says does not use stack. It does use stack. So whenever you call one function one after the other, it stores the function calls in a stack inside the system, and then it is going to use it to evaluate the values of variables and etc. So if it will, you'll come to know this if you read about recursion deeply and its implementation. So this is the correct answer. So this is a false statement. So we'll go to our last question. So this is a 10th question and we still have 7 minutes left. Okay, there was some disturbance here, so I had to pause the video and record it again also, but still we had so much of time, so we can chill out, take the exam easily, but you have to prepare for it. So don't miss out on preparation, and you can easily crack this examination. So what is the output of the following code snippet? It says include main, hash include main in const a equal to 5, a++, printf % d of a. So what will be the output is that since this is a constant variable, we have covered this in our previous videos, 5 will be the answer, okay? So you'll not get a runtime error, you'll not get 6, you'll get not get a compile time error also. So, but let us check this. So what happens is, let us delete this code, and what let us say is int const a equal to 5. Let us say a++, and let us say printf % d of a. Okay, so whenever we run this program, you may get an error, okay, increment of read-only variable a. So a is a read-only variable since this is a constant. So this depends upon the compiler also. So let me say, since I'm on a Windows, it gave me an error. So the option can be compile time error, but I have executed the same program in Linux platforms various times also. So that will give me 5. So I'm a little confused for this, but compile time error is also right answer. So since we saw this real time, so I could not show you the execution on Linux because I don't have the Linux on my system right now. So we can say this is a right answer. So the question again came back to the first question. So we can see here all the 10 questions are answered. So we can now submit this section, and we have all answered all the 10 questions. So yes, I want to end the submission of the programming group, and now this will go to an coding question, which we will have 20 minutes. So this is the question, and we will have to write our C program here, okay? So we'll only have one question and 20 minutes. So we did our 30-minute coding challenge. Actually, what happened is that previous year it was 20 minutes. So this year they notified us saying that there will be 30 minutes to solve the problem. But this is still showing 20 minutes for me. I don't know why. So we don't need 20 minutes to answer this question. This is a simple question. So I don't know what will be the structure in the final exam. I think it will be 30 minutes, but in the mock test they have given us still 20 minutes. So let us read the program. Question, what it says is, write a program as per the below specifications. So the first statement is accepts one integer number, which will be a two-digit number. Okay, you will get a two-digit number from std input from the keyboard. So interchange the two digits of the number. So we have to interchange the number. So if they enter 34, we have to print 43. So that is a program, that's it. So this is a simple program, okay? So I'm not able to delete it. Okay, yeah. So print the resulting number to the std out. For example, if the input value is 21, the program will print 12, that is the reverse. It can be assumed that the input value will be such that there will be no zero as any of the two digits. Other than the calculated numerical output value, no other strings or messages should be printed out. So this is fairly a simple program. We'll write this code in our IDE. So what? So I think you all have understood the problem. So the problem says that they will be giving us a number. So let us say they gave us a 25. Okay, they will only give us a two-digit number if you have read the question correctly. Okay, they will give us a two-digit number and none of this digit will be zero. Okay, none of this digit will be zero. So if this digit is zero, so for example, if they give us 30, the reverse of it will be 03. So that is not that this will not be a case. So they will not give us. So if they gave us 25, so what we should print is we should print 52. Okay, this is fairly simple. So how to do this? So I'm going to explain you the process of doing that also. So let us say they have entered 25. Okay, let us consider this. Okay, so this is the given number. Let us say I will use this as num. Okay, so what I should do is I'll take the 25 and I'm going to divide it by 10. So what will I get? So 10 divided by 25 in integers, it will store 2. Okay, so 10 twos are 20 and this 5 remainder will be ignored since this is an integer type. Okay, so I'll store it in an integer variable. So we will get 2. That is the first digit. So we have successfully extracted the first digit. Now what I'll do is I'll do 25 percentage, that is mod 10. So this will give us the remainder. So 10 twos are 20 and 5 is the remaining one, right? So we will get 5. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to store it in two variables called digit 1 and digit 2, and I'll redefine my num variable as digit 2 into 10 plus digit 1. So what this will do is it will take the 5 and multiply it by 10, that becomes 50, and it adds the digit 1, that is 2, and the resulting number will be 52. That is my answer. Okay, so this is a fairly simple program. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to declare a variable called int num, and I'll take the input, that is my scanf spelling is wrong. So I'm going to take the input, that is percentage %d ampersand num, that will give me the number. So next what I'm going to do is I'm going to say int digit 1 and digit 2. Okay, so what I'm going to do is let us say digit 1 is equal to num by 10, digit 2 is equal to num mod 10. Sorry, I didn't get the mod correct. So num mod 10. So next what I'm going to do is I'm going to say num is equal to digit 2 into 10 plus digit 1. So this will store the number in the reverse format. So next what I'm going to do is I'm just going to print the digit that we have just calculated. So this is a fairly simple program. So I'm printing out num. So when I run this program, what I'm going to get is, so let us say I'll enter 25, so I'll get 52. So one thing I can do is I can make this program is already simpler, right? So I can make this program more simpler. So what I can do is I can delete this, okay, unnecessary code. Okay, after taking the num as input, what I can do is I can say num by 10 or num mod 10. Okay, num mod 10 will give me 5, the second digit. Okay, as we have seen here, num mod 10 will give me the second digit. So I have to multiply the second digit by 10, and then I have to add num by 10 to this. So that will add the first digit, and this is the answer. So this is a reduced form of the code. So if I am going for like a condensed form of this program, so this program will end in like 9 lines, which is a single digit number. So in 9 lines, you're going to get the answer for this program. So this will also run, say I'm going to enter 67. So I'm going to get 76 as the answer. So just copy this question. So in your examination, okay, so please remember this, don't do this. So you don't exit the programming window. So since this is a mock test, I am doing that. please don't exit the mock test. So you have to code here itself and submit the program, okay? So please don't exit it. So I'm going to submit the code. I'll recompile this code. In the actual exam, your code will get compiled on click of this button. So this is not an actual exam, so they're not going to compile this, okay? So you can just submit this and it will say you can use C language, C++, Java, Python and Perl programming languages to solve this, okay? So we have taken C, okay? So I could also have taken C or Java. I know all this, except for Perl. I don't know this Perl programming language. So this is like an old programming language. So except for this, they have even written the spelling of the Python wrong. Okay, so I don't know all these programming languages, but I took C since because we have practiced C language in our previous videos in this channel. So that is the end of the examination. I ended my examination. Thank you. Your exam is about to be submitted. Click OK to proceed. Are you sure you want to submit the exam? So at the last moment, you want to change your program. So you can click cancel and you can go back and edit your code again. Okay, but you cannot go to your previous parts like MCQs and English questions. Okay, so I'm going to click OK now. My test will be submitted and it will show me feedback form where I can answer a question about seating arrangement. So you have to go to the test center and write it. So they're going to ask you feedback about how was the examination, how was the seating arrangement, how was the staff in the how were the staff in the examination center, were they friendly to you, etc. So you can give the feedback and your examination is complete. So after you get this information in your test center, you can easily walk out of your test center with a happy face, thinking that you have easily solved the TCS NQT examination. So that is about this video. So my bad. So thank you for watching this video. If you have any questions about the questions that were solved in this mock examination, do comment them below. So subscribe to our channels for more videos on any interview preparation, examination, any study stuff. We are here to help you to study. And once again, thank you for watching.